I started writing the Lola Quartet in the spring of 2009, which was a moment of utter economic upheaval in the United States. The economic collapse around that time was extraordinary. It was quite unlike anything that we'd ever experienced. And so I found myself in this utterly surreal time when the banks were collapsing at a rate of one or two per week. It was mass unemployment. It was quite dark and quite surreal, and I wanted to write about this very strange moment in history at which I'd found myself. So I knew I wanted to write about the economic collapse, and I was also fascinated by this phenomenon of journalists who plagiarize in their work. And what interests me about that is that these are very intelligent people, and by nature of their work, they're creating a paper trail, a trail of evidence. And yet, this does happen over and over again. We see Jason Blair at the New York Times, Stephen Glass at the New Republic, just to name two examples in the United States. There have been several others. So I wanted to write about a character who did that and to think about what might drive a person to make such a catastrophic error in their professional lives. And at the same time, I am fascinated by music. I wanted to write about Django Reinhardt, who fascinates me. His friendship with Stefan Grappelli and his work in sort of combining gypsy and jazz music. So it was a matter of several obsessions coming together with this book. And as far as the plot goes, we open with Gavin, who's he's had a difficult time. His girlfriend recently suffered a miscarriage, and he finds himself a bit adrift and begins to slide a little bit in his professional life. And that slide builds momentum until he reaches the point where he's fired in disgrace from a high-profile job at a New York City newspaper. And this is the spring of 2009. There are no jobs, especially not in journalism, which is a difficult industry at the best of times. But he really doesn't want to return to his hometown in Florida to sell foreclosed real estate with his sister. That's absolutely the last thing he wants to do. But he feels that he really doesn't have a choice. So he goes down to Florida, and his sister tells him that she recently encountered a 10-year-old girl who has the same last name as Gavin's high school girlfriend, who he last saw 10 years earlier, and who looks very much like Gavin. So he becomes obsessed with this idea that he might have a daughter. And if he does have a daughter, is she in trouble? And he wants to live honorably, even though he's fallen so spectacularly. He wants to be a better man. So he begins to conduct a sort of personal investigation to find out what happened to this child, and if she is in fact in danger, which all signs seem to point to. And he does so. His starting point is to interview his fellow members of a jazz quartet from high school. I think it's fair to say that I have returned to many of the same themes over and over in my work. And one doesn't necessarily intend to do so, but you begin writing a book, and even though it seems to you to be an entirely new story, there is a point when you might begin to realize that you are once again touching on these themes that have recurred. And I do find myself fascinated by memory as a topic, the way in which three different people can witness the same event and come away with three entirely different versions of what happened, all of which they believe personally to be factually correct. It's something that interests me, which is why I structure my books in the way that I do, with the multiple points of view and moving back and forth in time. I do find myself fascinated by music. It's something that I've always loved. And I am fascinated by flight, both personally and as a topic for my writing. So I think that's true. I think it's fair to say that I have returned to these same themes several times.